morning and welcome to worship this morning at Station Hill. If you would stand with us and join us this morning, it's 2018 Sunday. Let's sing.
We waited for this day, we're gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, will burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we wanna see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river. Your glory on our face, we're looking to the sky. Descending like a cloud, you're standing with us now. Lord, unveil our eyes. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise.
Thank you, church family. It's great to hear you sing to start this new year together. Would you be seated for just a few moments this morning? A couple of announcements for you as we welcome you here to worship at the church at Station Hill. One is, if you're a guest with us, we're glad you're here. We have a communication card at the bottom of the bulletin. We'd love for you to tear that off and drop it in the offering plate when it comes by, or hand it to one of our team. There's a place there for all of us to share prayer requests on the back if there's things you would like us to know. Also on the back of that bulletin, a couple of important things to let you know about. Today is welcome reception. reception day. And so if you're new to the life of our church, we want to invite you to a free luncheon for you and your family right after this service up in the student ministry area. Love for you to get to know us as a staff, get to know a little bit about the story of our church, have a chance to ask questions. No obligation, but kind of a first step in the journey of getting to know us better and deciding and determining whether or not this would be your church home. Also, our activities are beginning to ramp back up. Tonight, all discipleship leader meeting. Wednesday night, all of our Wednesday night activities resume. And then next Sunday, most of our life groups and focus studies resume as well if they haven't started back already. So it's a special Sunday for us, and I love to begin our services this way. So we've got a special parent-child dedication this morning. So the Dodgians are going to come and join me here on the platform. And you will see John and Sharon and the boys and this beautiful dress and this beautiful girl. Everybody ooh and ah, all right? So this is Anna Claire. And her life verse that her parents have chosen for her comes from Psalm 139. That passage where it says, "How precious to me are your thoughts, O God, how vast the sum of them. If I would count them, they are more than the sand." We know that Anna Claire is a precious gift. And that passage, of course, goes on to talk about how she is fearfully and wonderfully made. So we believe that she is a special gift of God's provision to this family. And we believe that all of our children need to be rooted in the Word of God. So we're going to ask the brothers to hold her first Bible here, the Jesus Storybook Bible, for her. And we know that she's going to be in a home in which the gospel is going to be both read and shared and lived out in front of her. And so what a privilege this is, as John and Sharon today stand here to commit their daughter before you to the Lord. And it's a moment for us as a faith family as we come around them and pledge to support them. So would you join me by standing this morning? If we had time, just like we do during prayer and altar time, we'd put our hands on their shoulder, but instead, would you just symbolically place your hand out like this, and I'm gonna hold this sweet baby girl, and let's pray together over her. Heavenly Father, I thank you for Anna Claire. I thank you for the gift that she is to John and Sharon and the boys and her extended family. Father, I thank you for the gift that she is to all of us, a reminder of your creative power and your faithfulness. So God, we pray your provision over her life. God, we know that she's fearfully and wonderfully made, and we pray that from a very young age, she comes to hear and respond to your gospel, that she will spend her days living out the plan and purpose that you've created her for. So God, we dedicate her to you now, and it's in the matchless name of Jesus we pray, and all God's people said, amen. Before you're seated, take a couple moments and say Happy New Year to those who are seated around you. On your mark, get set, go.
Okay, we'll come back.
Remain standing as we continue worship. Sing.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God. That cannot fall. Savior as my all in all, standing on the promises of God.
Promises from God out of Joshua 1:9. Read this with me. Have I not commanded you, be strong and courageous? Do not be afraid, do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. Let's sing these truths this morning.
Standing on this mountaintop, looking just how far we've come, knowing that for every step you are with us. Kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing every victory is your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. Just how much you've done, knowing every victory is your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say. Never once did we ever walk alone.
Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own.
Heavenly Father, we've seen through your promises in your word, Lord, that you will be with us every step. Lord, may we be strong and courageous as we move into the world beyond us and shed the glory and light of Jesus Christ to a darkening place. It's in Christ's name we pray. Let's sing.
I'm laying down my life. I'm giving up control. I'm never looking back. I surrender all. I'm living for your glory on the earth. This passion in my heart, this stirring in my soul, to see the nations rise, for all the world to know, I'm living for your glory on the earth. For the sake of the world, burn like a fire in me, light a flame in my soul for every eye to see. For the sake of the world, burn like a fire in me.
Set this passion in my heart.
This passion in my heart, this stirring in my soul, to see the nations rise, for all the world to know, I'm living for your glory on the earth. For the sake of the world, burn like a fire in me, light a flame in my soul. Like a fire.
fire in me. Amen.
Well, good morning. That's the perfect segue to our prayer and altar time. You can be seated. This is a time in our service where we take a moment to just quiet our hearts and still ourselves before the Lord. But it's also the time in our service when we pray together as a church for an unreached people group. And so if you're new to our church, we do this every month. We choose a different group around the world, and we pray together for them, a group of people that doesn't have access to the gospel. So I have a question for you this morning. Did anybody get a new Bible for Christmas? Anybody toting a new Bible this morning? Yes. My daughter over here did. She had a journaling Bible that she wanted, so she got that for this Christmas. And maybe you've seen the ads that we've put up about the reading the Bible for a year. Brian has put this link out. You can get to it on our website. It's a Bible reading group. I've joined it. It's been really fun this week to be reading the same thing with a bunch of people. Then they can comment on what they have learned from that. I'd encourage you to be a part of that. But this week, in light of the new Bibles and the new Bible app and starting over a brand new year, it's just reminded me of how much access I have to God's Word. This is just one of my Bibles. It's my travel Bible that I take with me whenever I go on a journey, and I love it. But we have all of these Bibles, have a shelf at home with all kinds of Bibles, all different translations, even different languages. And we're so accustomed to having access to the gospel, access to scripture, that a lot of times we take it for granted and maybe go a whole week without ever picking it up. But there are billions with a B of people around the world that have never held a Bible in their hands. They've never seen Holy Scriptures. They don't know that God made a way for them to be with him through his son Jesus. And so that is why we do this. That is why every month we pick a new people group somewhere in the world to pray for. And we try to choose a people group that somehow our church is connected to. And so this month we are going to be praying for the northern Yemeni people. So you'll see a slide of them on the screen eventually. And there they are. And so this is a picture that you can pray for this man. He represents this people group. We have a couple in our church that is a part of a ministry that is intentionally reaching out to this people group, but not in Yemen, where you might think. In Dearborn, Michigan is where they're reaching. There are 15,000 people from this people group that live in the Detroit area. Now, you and I, it would be really difficult for us to hop on a plane and get to Yemen, but we can get to Detroit. So this is where God has strategically put this group of people so that when they hear the gospel, if they respond, then they can go back to Yemen and they can carry the gospel with them. So statistically, this people group registers on Joshua Project as 0.00% evangelical. So that is as unreached of a people group as you can get. So you can see why we've chosen them to pray for this month. So this picture will stay up on the screen in just a moment. We'll pray. It's a time for you to take anything before the Lord that you need to. But I just ask that while you're praying, that you would pop your eyes up to the screen and that you would pray for a moment for the people of this particular people group. I've got brand new prayer cards. I'll be passing them out in the atrium after the service. I just encourage you to pick one up, take it, stick it in the dashboard of your car. You can pray when you're in traffic. Pray as you pray for your meal this afternoon, as you're saying the blessing, say a prayer for the people of the Northern Yemeni people group, as you're praying at night with your kids. Just keep in front of you this month, and we will pray, call out to God for salvation for this group. Jay will be coming forward in just a minute. You can come and pray over him as he prepares to bring us the message. But let's take a moment right now to do that.
Thank you.
The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. Lord, we've been reading this scripture in light of Christmas and light of the incarnation of Jesus. But Lord, we just pray this scripture today on behalf of the Northern Yemeni people group, Lord. We know that right now there are 15,000 people of this people group living in Michigan, Lord, that are walking in darkness, that do not know that you sent your son Jesus to save them from their sins and that they have the opportunity to have eternal life through him. And so right now, God, we just cry out on behalf of this people group, on behalf of the people who are working tirelessly to reach them, to make contacts and to have a chance to share the gospel with them. Lord, we just pray that you would bring salvation to them. But Lord, we know there are people in this room today that have full access to the gospel and that they are still walking in darkness, Lord, because their eyes are still blinded to the truth of Jesus and how you've brought him to save us. So Lord, I pray that today would be the day of their salvation, that you would open eyes and open ears in this room, Lord, and that people would come to know you today for the first time. I pray for Jay as he comes to bring the message, Lord, just give us the ears to hear what you have to say to us today. Give him the words to speak. Thank you, God, for love and mercy for Jesus. It's in his name that we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning. As we start off the new year, I know that many of you have kicked off your New Year's resolutions. You're trying to build in new habits. Maybe you're working out, you're simplifying, you're doing a new schedule. You'll be happy to know that I'm continuing my yearly resolution to eat bacon at least 2 to 3 times per week. But whatever it is for you, you're thinking about how you're going to start off this new year, how you're going to invest your time and your resources. I want to encourage you today to think about how you're investing your time to be a part of biblical community. As you came in today with your bulletin, you received this Life Group and Focus Study brochure. On the inside of it, it's got a list of all of our different life groups, which are our small groups that you can be connected to, and our focus studies that go on throughout the week. And our focus studies focus on a topic or a book of the Bible. And these are the on-ramps for you to get connected to biblical community. As believers, as followers of Christ, we were never meant to do this journey on our own. We weren't supposed to just be isolated. We were meant to be in relationship with other believers that would encourage us, that would sharpen us, challenge us when we need to be challenged, and build us up so that we can look more like Christ. So as you're thinking about what is God calling me to this year, consider how he's calling you to be a part of biblical community. I'm going to be in the atrium just after the service is done. I'll be standing by the discipleship area. I would love to talk to you more about how you can get connected. There is a place for you within this brochure. There's groups for men, women, all different age demographics. There's groups that meet in different subdivisions throughout the city and the area. Find a place to where you can fit in and where you can connect and be challenged and encouraged by God's word. Because God has given us this great grace by giving us the church, by being able to be around and build up one another. So let's consider as we start this new year, in light of all that God has done for us, how we can use our time wisely to be invested in his word and building one another up. So now as our ushers come forward, we're going to pray, and I want you to pray mindfully of how you're responding to all that God has done for you with your time, your talent, your treasure, and your testimony. Let's pray together. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for today. God, we thank you just for your love that you've given us, for all that you've provided for us, and Father, most of all, for who you are. God, you've blessed us with the ability to be a part of a community. As your followers, we don't have to do it on our own. We don't have to be isolated. We don't have to struggle through life by ourselves. But God, in your grace and in your providence, you gave us the church. And Lord, we thank you for that. I pray for my brothers and sisters who are here today. I pray that you would give them the wisdom to know what the next step should be for them. I pray that you would help them to find a connection and to make new friends and to be in an encouraging relationship where they can know more of your word and be challenged by it, convicted when they need to, and built up by it. But Father, I pray that we would do all of this not so that we can just say that we're in a group this semester, but Father, I pray that we would do it so that we would draw closer to you, that we would be transformed by your word, and that ultimately, Father, by your spirit, you would lead us to glorify you with our lives. So, Lord, we thank you so much for your grace that has saved us and has given us one another. We love you, and we thank you for Christ. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
Man, well, thank you, Brian. All of you who would like to join his bacon consumption accountability group, can we see a show of hands today? So, all right, there you go. Well, as you take your Bibles this morning, we're going to be in Acts chapter 11. We're going to spend the next 4 weeks looking at the church at Antioch as we kick off this year. But as you grab your Bible, a couple things I want to let you know about. One is, beginning this Sunday, you will hear myself and all of other campus pastors preaching out of the Christian Standard Bible, the CSB. Many of you know that for years we have been using the Holman Christian Standard Bible, published by our friends at Lifeway. And of course, us pastors liked it because it gave us a little joke with the initials HCSB, Hardcore Southern Baptist, right? Translation of the Bible. But over the years, they incrementally released updates, and they decided about a year ago just to go ahead and overhaul the entire translation. And so they have done so. And so we're moving to that translation. Now, your HCSB that you have, if you've invested in one of those, it'll still be very, very close. But we've just decided, because all the kids and student curriculum will line up with that, all of the new mission resources that are released will be using the CSB. We're going to preach out of that translation. If you don't have a Bible, if you need a Bible, if you know someone who needs a Bible, we're going to have paperbacks of the CSB available for free at the new Discipleship Center out there to the left. So feel free to grab one of those if you want that. And for those of you, of course, using a digital version, you just now have to search for the CSB, Christian Standard Bible, and you will arrive at exactly the wording that we'll be preaching out of on Sunday mornings. But we're excited about this new year and all that God is doing. And any Tennessee Titan fans out there? So, all right, yeah, everybody happy today? Kind of unexpected, shocker, won a playoff game. This week, I heard on the radio that the Titans had not been to the playoffs since January of 2009. And so the way that my brain works is I thought back to January 2009 and what was taking place then. Did you realize that the Church of Station Hill didn't exist the last time the Tennessee Titans were in the playoffs? I don't know if that says more about their ineptitude the last 8 years or it speaks more to what God has done in a short period of time here, relatively speaking. But I definitely went back to that moment in my mind and I began to think about January of 2009 and where I was and what I was doing. And on a cold January night, in Wilson Hall, which is the fellowship hall at our Brentwood campus, a group of us gathered together who had been prayerfully talking about being a part of the launch team for the first campus out of our church. And on that night, we challenged people to commit. And so with Chris Barker, by the way, leading worship, so that was appropriate today. I want to put up a picture of this for you on the screen. We had 50 families who took a launch team covenant, and they placed it on a door, symbolically stating that we wanted to be a part of creating new doors into the life of our campus and what God was doing in our community. You'll see there the picture of the team that went on to complete that spring, the launch team training. And it's interesting because it's kind of fuzzy now, and we've looked for a better resolution copy kind of for church history purposes, and we can't find one, basically because it was an afterthought. I think we pulled out maybe an iPhone 2, right? And somebody snapped a picture of this group of people. And you know, I kind of like it that way. It's just interesting to think about how God uses people, faithful people, ordinary people like you and me to accomplish his purposes. And you know, it was interesting because in that same month, many of you will remember that the recession had hit hard. And so there were many people who came and kind of told me, hey, is this the best time to put resources and to launch campus? And other people within our church family say, you know, we don't really do the church multiplication thing very well. Maybe this isn't a good idea. I had other people here in the community of Spring Hill say, like, really? Like, every strip mall in Spring Hill has two things, right? A Mexican restaurant and a new church, right? Does Spring Hill really need another church? Well, take a look around at you, look around this morning. Ponder all that God has done. In the last 8 years, there've been almost 300 people baptized. In the last 8 years, we've sent 250 people out of this congregation to serve alongside of mission partners nationally and internationally on mission journeys. Because this church began to have traction and grow roots and begin to thrive in this community, our larger church family caught a hold of a vision for multiplication, and there are now 5, soon to be 6, maybe 7 campuses meeting throughout Middle Tennessee today, declaring the good news of Jesus in their own community because this group of people were just simply willing to say, hey, I want to reach my neighbors. And you know, one of the things I love about the scriptures is the fact that they point to the fact that God simply uses faithful people to accomplish his purposes. The church we're going to spend the next 4 weeks looking at, the church at Antioch, as we start this new year as a model for us, was not started by the apostles. It wasn't started by Barnabas. It wasn't started by the apostle Paul. No, it was started by a bunch of people who we don't even know their names, who simply told their neighbors about Jesus. And out of their faithfulness came the world's first great mission-sending church, the church at Antioch. As we enter a new chapter, a new season in the life of our church, that's what I want our church to look like. I love what God has done up to this point in the past 8 years. I can't wait to see what he's going to continue to do as the vision for what he can accomplish through faithful people only grows larger and larger. So will you stand with me in honor of God's word as we begin into Acts chapter 11 with verses 19 through 21 this morning. Now those who had been scattered as a result of the persecution that started because of Stephen, made their way as far as Phoenicia, Cyprus, and Antioch, speaking the word to no one except Jews. But there were some of them, men from Cyprus and Cyrene, who came to Antioch and began speaking to the Greeks also, proclaiming the good news about the Lord Jesus. The Lord's hand was with them, and a large number who believed turned to the Lord. Speak, Lord, for your servants are listening. Pray with me this morning. Oh, Heavenly Father, thank you that we don't have to go far to find the mission and vision of your church. It's right there in the pages of Scripture. And so, Father, our responsibility is to be sure that our church lines up with biblical truth, with these biblical principles. So, Father, would we be diligent and urgent and intentional in making sure that our church reflects the values of the church at Antioch, the first church to catch hold of the vision for worldwide mission? Would we value the things that your heart values? Thank you for sending your son who makes it all possible. And it's in his name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. You may be seated this morning. So my goal for today's message is pretty simple. I want us to begin looking at the church at Antioch. I'm going to spend more time in these first 3 verses and kind of highlight the rest of the story at the church at Antioch because we'll be going back to revisit those parts of the story later this month. But I also want you to understand how those tie into the things that we value as a church and the things that we want to uphold as a people, the things that we should and want to value as well. And last but certainly not least, I want you to think the whole time in your mind, how is the Lord calling me to be a part of what he's doing here through my local church family? And if you're not joined with us, should you consider joining with us on the great mission that God has given us? But I love the portrait that we get at the church at Antioch for several reasons. One is, of course, it's in the great scope of the story of what God is doing in the book of Acts. We call it the Acts of the Apostles, but it really should probably be called the Acts of the Holy Spirit because it's about how Jesus gave a mandate, a commission to his disciples. He looked at them when he ascended back to heaven and he said, you will be my witnesses. Imperative, you, right? Emphatic, you. The mission was entrusted to disciples of Jesus, to his followers. You will be my witnesses when the Holy Spirit comes on you, right? And you will receive my power and you will be witnesses in Jerusalem, the place where you're at. You will be my witnesses in Judea, regionally, Samaria, right? To people who were traditionally the enemies of the Jewish people. They didn't get along. So you will be witnesses to people that you think are outside of the scope of God's work, to people that you don't get along with any other way, and ultimately to the ends of the earth. And what's fascinating is if you begin to walk through the book of Acts, you will begin to see that that's the exact format that Luke lays out for us as the Holy Spirit moves in those ways. It's interesting that scholars have observed that the church advanced by intentional gospel effort, right? To share the gospel, to plant churches, and to bring the gospel to new places, Acts 1:8. But there were also times when the gospel was advanced via Acts 8:1. And in Acts 8:1, we see Saul, who later became Paul, beginning his murderous attacks against the early church. And it says that the church was scattered out of Jerusalem. That word scattered, the same word in the first verse that we read today. And what's interesting about that word is that it's an agricultural word. It's a word that is literally the word picture in Greek of a farmer sowing seeds. And so what you need to see here is the reality is that the gospel will move forward under the power of the Holy Spirit. Sometimes it happens very intentionally when churches step forward in the mission, but sometimes it happens despite ourselves. Let's be honest, sometimes we get comfortable and the church has to be pushed out of its comfort zone. And so what you see is the church there residing in Jerusalem, all of a sudden shaken, but as the believers scatter for the sake of their lives, they carry what? The gospel with them. You see, what Satan always intends to sabotage, God will always superintend for his divine plan and his sovereign purposes. You see, the enemy is not omniscient. And so he unleashes a string of circumstances and events that he thinks will frustrate and stop the work of the Holy Spirit. But that work cannot be stopped. And so it's interesting when we begin to think about how we scatter in our day and age today. There are not very many of you who were born and raised in Spring Hill, Tennessee. Any locals among us today? Okay, a handful, right? Most of us have come here. Yes, kids, yes, you do count. I saw several kids put their hands up. True, right? So it'll be a little different in the next generation in Spring Hill because there'll be a bunch of you who were born and raised here. But among us adults, many of us moved here, whether for a job or for better education for our family, those kind of purposes. There are others of you who, the events of life have found you in this place. And you might find yourself wondering on some days, God, how in the world did I get here? Why am I in this house or this apartment in this neighborhood? Why am I in this job next to these people? Why am I in this school? Why am I rubbing shoulders with this group of people? But you see, what this passage teaches us is that God doesn't scatter people by accident. He does so intentionally. Because when we go and we recognize that our first priority, wherever we find ourselves, is the gospel of Jesus Christ, suddenly that transforms the reason that we're there. We know that God has put us there for a reason and a plan and a purpose. And so you're not here by accident. The other remarkable thing about this passage, of course, is the city of Antioch itself. Now, we read that, and for us, it's just another in a list of ancient cities. But you need to understand that Antioch was the third largest city of the Roman Empire at the time, behind only Rome and Alexandria. It was called the Queen City of the East. It was a major hub for commerce and trade. They had a port that fed into the Mediterranean Sea off a river there. It was a pluralistic culture in which people of different belief groups had come from all over the ancient Near East to congregate and gather there. It was a city of about half a million people. And when you begin to think about that, you begin to realize that this was an ideal place, an ideal launching pad for the global mission of the gospel, because if it could take root in Antioch, the types of people who would be drawn to that city and then would spread out from there, the gospel would be carried all over the world. As a matter of fact, you might call Antioch the it city, right, of the first century in that part of the world. What do they call Nashville right now? The it city, right? God has drawn you to a regional hub. Sometimes it's called the third coast. You know why? Because next to New York and LA, no community, no city has greater impact on culture and the shaping of culture in North America probably than little old Nashville, Tennessee. People are moving here by the droves, which we know increases traffic, right? But it also increases our influence and our ability to impact the people that God is bringing here, maybe for a season, so that they can know and hear the gospel, and so that this can be a launch pad. What an opportunity, what a privilege, what a time to be alive and to be a servant of Jesus Christ. That God is literally flooding our neighborhoods and our towns with thousands of families, with people who are hurting, searching, looking for answers. Did you know there are going to be 1,000 housing units built within 1 mile of this campus within the next 24 to 36 months? That's more people that God is bringing right here to our very doorstep with whom we can share the hope of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I know you're having to say, traffic, traffic, get that out of my head, right? Gospel opportunity, gospel opportunity. But that's the reality. God has given us this moment. He's given us this chance. And what's fascinating about this story to me, as I mentioned earlier, God used a bunch of people and we don't even have their names to see a major barrier and threshold to the gospel crossed. You see, chapters 10 and 11 tell the story of Peter leading Cornelius, a Roman centurion, to faith. And so verse 18, the verse right before the one that we begin to read, reads this, talking about the report that came back to the church at Jerusalem. When they heard this, they became silent. They were literally speechless, trying to deal with the implications of what had just happened. Someone with a non-Jewish background and a hated Roman soldier at that had come to faith in Jesus Christ. And then they glorified God, saying, so then, God has given repentance resulting in life for salvation even to the Gentiles. In other words, the gospel was not just for people with a Jewish background, but the gospel was for all people. And the rest of Luke's story in Acts is filled with these stories now of the gospel going to the Gentiles. And so what happens here is the believers are spread to Antioch, verse 20. But there were some of them, men from Cyprus, which is an island just about 100 miles off the coast, and Cyrene, which was in northern Africa at the time, who came to Antioch. We talked about how it was a hub, and began speaking to the Greeks also, proclaiming the good news about the Lord Jesus. Now we have the saying in our Baptist churches, right? Well, we've never done it that way before, right? One of our favorite things to say. Well, here's what happens when new people get saved. They don't know the tradition of the church. They don't grasp, we've never done it that way before, because they've never done anything before. All they want to do is tell people about the Jesus who has saved them. And so lo and behold, these guys, ignorant of the traditions, right, go and share Jesus with their neighbors who happen to speak Greek. They're Greek speaking. And it so happens that many of them respond to the gospel. Now, I want you to notice one thing, and it's easy to miss. They spoke to them about the Lord Jesus. Notice it doesn't say Messiah Jesus. Now, if these people had a Jewish background, it would make sense to speak to them about the Messiah, Jesus, the fulfillment of all of the Old Testament promises. But Greek people don't know the Old Testament. Therefore, they use the word Lord Jesus, Kyrios. And here's what was amazing about that statement, is that everybody in the Roman Empire knew one person was Lord. Who was that? Caesar! Caesar was Lord, and to say anybody else was Lord was punishable in some places by death. And yet, here came these people who believed in Jesus, that he had come and died and he rose from the dead, and that he had saved them, and they were willing to say, no, Caesar is not Lord, Jesus is Lord. But notice how they contextualized the message to fit with the audience. The truth was the same. Jesus is Messiah and Lord, as Peter says in Acts chapter 2. He is both of those things. But to this audience, they made the message fit. And it's a great reason why we have to learn to be gospel fluent. We spent a lot of time this year, or the past year, and we're going to spend more time this year talking to you about this concept of gospel fluency. This is why you need to be in the Word. As Leanne and Brian shared with you earlier, this is why we challenge you to read the Word, to immerse yourself in it so that your words reflect the words of Scripture, so the overflow of your heart is the Word of God as it is translated, so to speak, into the lives of your neighbors, into the lives of your co-workers. In other words, Bible study isn't just about making you smarter so that you know more of the Bible, like so that you know more about Bible trivia or something, right? It's to transform you so that it can transform others. The Word that has come to you needs to flow through you into the lives of the people around you. And this is what we call gospel fluency. And this one little word gives us an indication that the church at Antioch, that these young believers knew the gospel and they were able to speak it to terms that their culture connected with. Now, to be very clear, that doesn't mean the message changed. The message never changes, right? The message of the gospel. But we have to be able to speak it in ways that connect with the people who are around us, the people who are our neighbors, the people who are our friends and coworkers and fellow students. And so we have to know the word so that we can share the word. And what was the result of this? Well, look at verse 21. The Lord's hand was with them, and a large number who believed turned to the Lord. So the first reason that the church at Antioch was so incredibly suited to be a model for us as a church was effective evangelism. Bottom line, it was the work of God in the lives of his people that made the difference. And then this leads us to reason number two, verse 22 through 24. News about them reached the church in Jerusalem, and they sent out Barnabas to travel as far as Antioch. When he arrived and saw the grace of God, he was glad and encouraged all of them to remain true to the Lord with devoted hearts. For he was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and of faith, and large numbers of people were added to the Lord. So after number one, effective evangelism, comes number two, dynamic disciple making. And again, you're going to hear more about these next three in subsequent weeks. That's right. It's New Year's, so not just three points today, but four, right? Because you can handle it. You're ready to go in the new year. But dynamic disciple making, where we see new churches that grow under godly leadership who know the priority of making disciples who will make more disciples. So the church at Jerusalem, we don't know if they were a little skeptical or if they just wanted to support the work that was going on there in Antioch or both, but they send one of their best, right? Barnabas. We were introduced to him in Acts 4. We know that his real name is Joseph. Barnabas is actually a nickname, which means son of encouragement, but that's how he was known by the church, and he is the right man for the job. He's trusted, he's respected, and he comes to see what God is doing at Antioch, and when he arrived and saw the grace of God, he was glad and he encouraged them. Every church needs its encouragers, and I love the encouragement that I see often happening among many of you to validate and to point out the grace of God operating in the lives of one another. Barnabas had the ability to do this, and in doing so, he strengthened the church. But not only that, something really curious happens in verse 25. As the church is continuing to grow, I feel like Barnabas had a great handle. He was a mature leader, and he knew that whereas he could have kind of been the star pastor and the CEO there at Antioch, he knew someone else was needed to strengthen the church. And so he forms the world's first one-man pulpit committee. He goes in verse 25 to Tarsus to search for Saul, who we know as Paul. And when he found him, he brought him to Antioch. And for a whole year, Luke points out, an entire year, they met with the church and they taught large numbers. So Barnabas and Paul in tandem teach the entire church for a year. They disciple them for a year. And what is the result? Well, the very community around them sees a change in this group of people. And the disciples were first called Christians at Antioch. Did you realize that? That we did not give the name Christians to ourselves. Instead, it was the unbelieving population of Antioch that looked at these followers of Jesus and said, these people look like little Christs. That's what the word Christian means. These people are smaller reflections of the Jesus that they love and serve. These people look like him, a smaller version of him, of course, but this is who these people are, that they're not just some sect within Judaism, but they're their own people group. They were that distinct and they stood out that much in the culture. And it begs the question for us today, if our culture was to label us, would they say the same thing? Would they look at us and say, hey, those people, man, they're just like the Savior and Lord that they claim to follow. They're just a smaller version, right? Or would they call us something else entirely? Well, it was there in Antioch that they were first called Christian, little Christ, a great testimony to what the Word of God was doing in them. But that's not where Luke ends the story. No, there's a third reason that this is a model church for us, and that's their faith-fueled generosity. Luke goes on to tell the story of how the gospel was bearing fruit in their life, in their giving. Verse 27, in those days, some prophets came down from Jerusalem to Antioch. One of them, named Agabus, stood up and predicted by the Spirit that there would be a severe famine throughout the Roman world. This took place during the reign of Claudius. And sure enough, first century historians like Josephus validate that the Nile River flooded in AD 45. And because that's where most of the grain came from for that part of the world at the time, there was a famine that followed. Verse 29, each of the disciples, according to his own ability, determined to send relief to the brothers and sisters who lived in Judea. And they did this, sending it to the elders by means of Barnabas and Saul. So can you imagine that you are a part of the mother church at Jerusalem, and all of a sudden Barnabas and Saul show back up and they're telling stories of the great things that God is doing in Antioch, and they're like, oh, and by the way, they produced some money bags and here's a great big offering. Well, what's this for? For the famine that's coming. Uh-oh, right? It would have totally caught them off guard because the famine hadn't happened yet. But the church at Antioch was so full of faith that they were willing to give to something that had not occurred because the Spirit was so much at work in their lives and their hearts. They didn't see their stuff as something for them to hoard, but for them to give, for them to steward. And you see, that's evidence of the work of the Spirit in our lives. I tell you guys all the time, you can tell me what your priorities are, but show me two things, and I'll tell you what really matters to you. Show me how you spend your time and how you spend your money, and I'll tell you what your real priorities are. And so that's why Luke concludes the story, because he wants us to know that this church was full of faith-filled generosity, that they trusted that God was going to provide, and if God could use them to bless the church that had blessed them with a leader like Barnabas, that he'd given them their spiritual roots, then they were more than ready to give back. And what's interesting is the story of the church at Antioch doesn't end there. Luke in chapter 12 moves to another story. He's a master storyteller, like a movie that follows several plot lines. He traces several throughout Acts. But at the beginning of chapter 13, we again see the church at Antioch. And this is reason four why this is such a model church for us, because they had a missional mindset that through prayer and obedience, they multiplied so that many would come to know Jesus as Lord. Acts 13, verse 1. Now in the church at Antioch, there were prophets and teachers. We call them the Antioch Five. Barnabas, Simeon, who was called Niger, Lucius, Manaen, a close friend of Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. And as they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them. And then after they had fasted and prayed and laid hands on them, they sent them off. What did they send them off to do? To be the world's first missionaries, to carry the gospel across the sea for the first time. You see, this is evidence of a faithful church. Did you notice who the Holy Spirit said to set apart? Barnabas, the senior pastor, basically, and Paul, the all-star teacher. In other words, the very best went to God's mission. And what a model for us of the heart of a missional God. As David Livingston, the missionary, said, God had only one son, and remember that he was a missionary. You see, this is where we get a glimpse of the gospel, that God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that God withheld nothing from us so that we could know him. In the same way, his churches should withhold nothing from him so that the world will know Jesus. And this is what our church should be about as well. And so to make it explicitly clear today, I want to put this on the screen. I want you to see that the Antioch way should be our way, that we want our values, the things that matter most to us, as we pursue the mission of engaging the whole person with the whole gospel of Jesus Christ. There are values that drive that. And so here's the way that our leadership team has framed those values for us. And I think very much they reflect what God was doing at the church at Antioch. Value number one, the gospel first and always. These are kind of our takeaways for today. So I want you to consider, do I value these things individually and as a home, as a family, so that we can, as a church, value these things corporately? Because Jesus is the hope for humanity. We are not ashamed of the gospel, Romans 1:16. Instead, we believe it has the power to save. As Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15, I want to share with you what was first given as of first importance to me. We want to know the gospel so we can be fluent in the gospel, so we can be sure that it is first and always in our hearts, in our lives, and in everything we do as a church. Value number two for us, because we are designed to play a role in God's kingdom. We are all uniquely called with the gifts and experience that God has given us to play a part in what God is doing in his local church. None of you are called to be spectators. All of you are called to be participants. So I pray that 2018 is the year that you double down on exploring your spiritual gifts, that you spend significant time exercising them, because like a muscle, they become stronger the more that you use them. Like Ephesians 4 tells us, I pray that you will find your place in the body of believers that we know as the church at Station Hill, because I believe that you are here for a purpose. And so as you join with us together, it's going to be fun to see how God works in and through his body of believers to make the good news known. Value number three for us is this. We call it intentional innovation. It's just a way of sharing that we value stewarding God's plans and resources, that we want to be intentional with what God has entrusted to us. And much like this first group of Christians at Antioch, we want to remove whatever barriers there are to sharing the gospel and the good news with people. If there are new wineskins, we want to use them. We want to use the most of every opportunity and resource that God has given us to leverage it for what matters most in his kingdom. Value number four is crossing cultures. We've already spoken to this several times in several ways in this worship service today. But we believe that we are blessed in order to be a blessing. We believe that at the end of time in the book of Revelation, we will see people gathered around God's throne from every ethnic group, every nation, every tongue, every tribe. And therefore, we are supposed to go to those who are different than us. That means, as I've already spoken to, both our neighbors that God is bringing to us from around the world, but we are also called to go to them, to go to the nations, because the light that shines the farthest also shines the brightest at home. And fifth, and last but definitely not least, we believe that because the gospel is for everyone, that multiplying matters, and we are committed to reproducing disciples. That means I have an individual call, that I am called to share the gospel with others, to be a disciple who makes disciples. That means our life groups and our focus studies don't exist for the sake of themselves. But as we disciple people in groups, there should be other groups launched that disciple more people. When we started back in 2009 in those first groups that were meeting to train, and then when we launched in 2010, we had about 6 life groups. We have somewhere north of 50 now, because we have leaders who have been faithful, right, to multiply groups. And guess what? As these people flood into our community, they need those personal connections. And so we have to continue to multiply. And of course, that means that as a church, we don't just exist to build up our own little kingdom, not at all. Instead, we exist to run people off, as the church at Antioch did, to build God's kingdom. So I know it's a lot to take in, I mean, just these few verses, the church at Antioch, but what a magnificent model for us to pursue. Being mindful that how did it all begin? With a few people who wanted to share the good news of Jesus with their neighbors. So your question today is, what's my next step? What do I need to do to engage the mission? There's a great little story that's told. I think it has the heartbeat of the group there at Antioch, of a little boy who wasn't raised in church, so he didn't quite understand why we do things the way that we do them. And he slipped in the middle of a service one time into the back pew. And as he was sitting there, right, as the deacon was praying for the offering, then as the plates started being passed down the row, he turned to an usher and said, what's everybody doing? He said, well, this is the moment in the service when people bring what God's given to them and they give it back to God so he can use it. And so the boy, of course, is looking through his pockets, and there's lint and there's some like chewed bubble gum and a few things in there, right? But nothing fit for the offering plate. So when it comes to him, it is something that usher said he'll never forget. He set that offering plate down and he stepped into it himself, right? Because it was all he could give. But what a great picture of surrendering all that we have to the mission of Jesus Christ. Here I am. I surrender all. What step do you need to take this year to be a part of what God is doing in and through his church? Will you join me as we pray? Heavenly Father, I thank you for this church family. I dearly love them. It has been a joy to watch them grow, to watch how you have shaped them into a body that you have used for your plan and purposes. Now, Father, I'm as excited as ever about the days that we have ahead of us. But Father, thank you for your word, for faithful examples of churches like Antioch, God, from which simply you launched your worldwide mission through people who just wanted to tell their neighbors about Jesus. God, would you find us faithful as well? And it's in your name we pray, and all God's people said, amen. Stand with us as Chris leads us in this song of commitment this morning.
For every knee to bow down, for every heart to believe, you were every voice to cry out, burn like a fire in me. For every tongue to confess that you alone are the King, you are the hope of the earth, burn like a fire in me. For every knee to bow down, for every heart to believe, for every voice to cry out, burn like a fire in me. For every tongue to confess that you alone are the King, you are the hope of the earth, burn like a fire in me. For the sake of the world, burn like a fire in me. Light a flame in my soul for every eye to see. For the sake of the world, burn like a fire in me. For the sake of the world, burn like a fire in me. Light a flame in my soul for every eye to see. For the sake of the world, burn like a fire in me. Burn like a fire in me. Burn like a fire in me. Burn like a fire in me.
Amen. Thank you, Chris, for leading us today. And that's the prayer of our heart, that God and his great plan and purpose, that would burn like a fire inside of us until all know him. So today, if you need to commit to him, if you need to turn away from yourself and to him as Savior, or if you need to commit and entrust your life, your resources, if you need to surrender all to him today, that's why we're here. I'm going to be down front in just a few moments. Our decision counselors, they're coming now. They're going to be to my right and my left. So there are people for you to pray with and talk with as we begin this world. I'm so excited about what God is going to do in and through you. I love you as a pastor. And I know that God has an incredible plan before us as we continue to seek to stay in step with his spirit and with his ways. So church, there's two things you need to know as we begin the journey of this year together. Number one, you are deeply loved. And number two, you are sent. Have an awesome Sunday.